surprised to see this many people here. That's a good thing. I appreciate you coming. So, a couple announcements. As you know, this week, we are not holding any labs. However, Wednesday's lecture will go forward as normal. And I don't know if we've posted it yet or if we're gonna post it today, but your homework will, if it hasn't yet, it has been posted. So your homework is going to be based on lecture, okay? The stuff that is in your homework, very, very little of it is actually from the book. So one of the things I can recommend is, of course, come to lecture. If you're gonna miss lecture on Wednesday, you're welcome to, everybody hopefully has access to the online lectures with Brett. Make sure you guys watch that. And the Monday lecture as well. Wednesday and Monday's lectures are quite involved, and if you don't watch them, you will have no freaking clue as to what's going on, okay? Because again, it is most of this content, or a lot of it rather, is not in your book, and your homework is based off of that. Now, I need to talk to Brett too, because I'm not 100% sure we're gonna get to all of this content with enough time to allow you guys to hand the homework in next week. So if we make any decisions on that, look for announcements. I have to talk to Brett and see if he thinks we're gonna get through or not, okay? So let's go ahead. We left with, where was I?
Here. Axon outputs.
Thank you. So helpful. Axon outputs. There we go. So 23. Okay. Okay. All right. Let's get started here. So we have for some neurons, axons are short or absent. Others, axons are very, very long. For example, there's one nerve, or not one nerve, but there's many, that they branch out of my spinal cord, and that one axon makes its way all the way down, literally to the tip of my toe. So that one axon can be, well, for me it's not very impressive, but if you look at, Yao Ming, you guys know who that dude is? That huge, tall Chinese guy, okay, like 7 foot something or another. I mean, that's one heck of a long axon. And then we have the axon begins at a cone-shaped area known as the axon hillock. We're going to be discussing this in much greater detail. This is the triggering center on the neuron for an action potential, right? So the action potential is not propagated throughout the entire neuron. In other words, it's not propagated through the cell body of the neuron. It's only propagated through the actual axon, and the axon hillock is where that message is going to start, was where the action potential is actually starting. We'll look at this in much more detail, okay? Then we have collaterals. You already know about these, right? An axon can split, right? One neuron is going to, one motor neuron is going to have these axons split into collaterals, and each of those collateral splits are going to go to a particular muscle fiber. So the cell body molecules, there's organelles, and they contain synaptic vesicles. This is, and again, they're filled with neurotransmitter. This should be nothing new to you because we talked about the motor neurons at the neuromuscular junction. These move by proteins walking on the cytoskeleton strands. So what we're saying here is that the neuron is able to get these different organelles and products, and vesicles filled with neurotransmitter, to and fro. A lot of them are made in the cell body and have to make their way down the axon. That's called anterior grade. It's going away from the cell body. Okay. So certain products are made by the cell, and it's in the cell body, and the axon could be across the room. Well, how do we get substances in the cell body that's here all the way down that axon? And that's via this method. Well, we also have, in some instances in a neuron, we also have retrograde travel. And that's travel towards the body. So don't get these two screwed up. Retrograde is going back towards the cell body. So it's going from the end of the axon backwards, right? Retrograde is going backwards. Anterior grade is going forwards, going from the cell body down the axon. So axonal branches can branch profusely. They have the ability, most of them in fact do. And some of them have, they're so branched that they have like 10,000 terminal branches. Now, think about this. Billions and billions of neurons in your central nervous system. And each one of those billions of neurons has 10,000 terminal branches. So 1 billion times 10,000, it's like incredible, right? That number of potential interactions between one neuron and another. Let's just call it a gazillion. That's the potential interactions. So they form multiple synapses to multiple or the same neurons or muscle fibers, and we'll look at that in much more detail in just a little bit. So the axon is going to end in a terminal, okay? And we call them again like terminal button or bouton. I don't care whatever way you want to say it. I don't say bouton because it sounds too fancy. But they end in those axon terminals, and that's where those neurons are going to house. In that area of the axon terminal is where those synapse vesicles are filled with whatever type of neurotransmitter that cell is specializes in. Okay. So the axon carries the action potential, and you've been a little bit exposed to this. That's that signal, you know, that travels not only across the axon, but also travels across the cell, the muscle cell membrane. The axon terminal, and we're gonna release neurotransmitters when the action potential gets to the axon terminal, just like in our motor neurons with skeletal muscle, okay? And we have this neurotransmitter release due to this calcium influx. Regulated by these voltage-gated calcium channels, right? The signal comes down, it's a change in voltage, calcium channels open, calcium comes in, we cause an exocytosis of neurotransmitter, and it's released into the synaptic cleft. Axons decay if cut or damaged, or they change to innervate a different synapse. So literally, these axons, to a degree, have the potential to change the synapse that they're at. And I think of it like, you know, they're growing. If you've ever like watched a time lapse of a vine growing, you know, the vine kind of meanders up through, that's really kind of analogous to how these axons are able to grow further and maybe perhaps make different synapses at different locations. Real quick note here, we have a lot of viruses and bacterial toxins that can damage neural tissues by using retrograde anaxonal transport. So the virus and or bacteria gets into the terminal portion of the neuron, and then it makes its way retrograde. It literally has these protein structures that, you know, kind of climb its way up that axon and then into the cell body. And some of these you've obviously heard of: polio, rabies, herpes simplex viruses, and tetanus. We talked about tetanus before. These toxins, or you know, have the potential to go retrograde, and then they're going to adversely affect the neuron, the cell body of the neuron, in different ways. So what's interesting is it says real quick here is that there's a lot of research now where they're going to try to take advantage of this retrograde type of transport. So you're going to have these, you know, one of the new fields of medicine is going to be this retrograde transport of these genes that correct for a lot of these different types of ailments. Okay. So here's a synapse. This is the postsynaptic cell, or presynaptic cell, rather, right? Here's the synapse. This is pre, this is post. We have a synaptic cleft. In other words, again, the neuron does not physically come in contact with its effector. Now, what do I mean by an effector? An effector is something that it affects. It could be another neuron, it could be a muscle fiber, it could be a sweat gland. Again, an effector is something affected by the release of these particular neurotransmitters, okay? Yeah. So we got a, you know, I think what, 200 neurotransmitters and counting. We're only going to study, you know, a very few of them, but of course these are the ones that are most used. And you know this, they released at the presynaptic membrane. They bind to receptors at the postsynaptic membrane, right? Ligand-gated channels here, guys. Ligand-gated channels. And then they're removed from the synapse by some means. Most of the time, it's by enzymes breaking them down, but there are certain neurotransmitters that are actually taken up by astrocytes, for example. Remember those cells I spoke of before that provide a scaffolding and support to the actual neurons, right? It's a glial, astrocytes are glial cells. They're glue of the neurons. So we have a couple different structures that you need to be aware of. Multipolar, this is the one we study a lot because it's involved. This is what a motor neuron is, okay? It's three or more processes, one axon, and then it breaks out to dendrites. And you'll see that, like I said, this is the most common and major neuron type in the central nervous system. So we study this a lot. Then we have bipolar neurons. There's two processes. So there's a cell membrane, or rather a cell body in between. There's an axon and a dendrite, the cell bodies in between. And we're gonna study these when we get into special senses. There's bipolar neurons involved with smell and with vision. And we'll get that, you know, cross that bridge when we get to it. Then there's a unipolar neuron, one T-like process. There's two pseudo-axons, and I'll show you what that means in a moment. They're also called pseudo-unipolar. And these are in the peripheral nervous system and then in the central nervous system as well. Okay. So let's look at these real quick. You guys are going to be responsible for identification of these types of neurons. It's pretty darn easy. This is the multipolar. You can see here that we have a cell body, a bunch of dendrites coming, branching off of that cell body or coming into it, whatever way you want to look at it. There is one single axon, and then it splits into these collaterals, and then it ends in these axon terminals. Okay? Bipolar, look, bipolar means there's one pole on one side and another pole on the other side, and this is where the cell body resides in between. So there's the dendrites portion of it, cell body, and then the axon. Okay. Unipolar is where it looks like a bipolar, and we just simply have the cell body off to the side. So this entire structure now is considered the axon. Okay. This is also known as pseudo-unipolar, and you would think that, you know, again, signal only travels down the axon. So if you think that this is the peripheral process and it's a dendrite, well, signals don't travel down dendrites technically. So this is all an axon, okay? And that's not really very important. Okay. But you'll notice here, look, this is the one we're gonna study most, and this is the trigger zone here. This is the axon hillock. This is where the action potential actually starts, okay? And we'll talk about what's gonna make that trigger an action potential, but then the action potential travels in one direction only, from its trigger zone, axon hillock, downwards. You're never gonna have action potential traveling retrograde for reasons we'll talk about later. So this is the trigger zone here, and it's gonna go down the axon. This is the trigger zone here, and it's gonna go down the axon. One direction only. And it's a good thing that it's one direction only. When I say it, I'm talking about an action potential. So you can see, now we're gonna get into a little bit, you'll notice that life is not as easy as just these, right? There's variations of each of these types of neurons. And just really quickly, if you look here, this is a multipolar neuron. You'll notice that the dendrites here, this is a very elaborate dendritic, this has a very elaborate dendritic system, as you can see. Here's the cell body, here's the axon, here's a collateral. This is also called, this is called the Purkinje cell in the cerebellum. These are responsible for coordination of your complex movements, like swinging the bat or, you know, signing your name, your signature. You ever wonder why it's always the same? Like, very, very similar. It's because these cells in your cerebellum are responsible for coordination of that. And we have a pyramidal cell. These are from your pyramidal system. Olfactory cell, you can see that this is bipolar because this is the dendrite, this is the axon. Here's a retinal cell, again, it's bipolar because this side's the dendrite, this side's the axon. And then we have a unipolar cell here. Okay. So you can see there's a couple examples of this. I'm not going to spend too much time on this because we're going to get to more detail in this in lab. You'll see this is a multipolar neuron, a typical motor neuron. The cell body resides in the CNS, and its axon only branches out of the central nervous system, becomes the peripheral nerve, and then of course is going to trigger, you know, particular muscle fibers. Here in the eye, we have bipolar neurons and unipolar neurons. These are involved a lot with sensory sensations, for example, touch, vibration, temperature, you know, pressure, all those kind of sensory information that your brain is getting is provided for by these unipolar type of neurons. Okay. Lab will look at these in much greater detail. Okay, so you have to think, this is, you know, this is just logical thinking. Neurons provide sensory information to your central nervous system, right? Again, I'm not looking, but I know I'm touching it now. I know I'm touching it now because, again, neurons are sending information up to my brain, and I'm consciously aware of that. Well, I also have to have motor activity to take something away, right, or create contractions. So neurons also have, you know, information going in, and there's information going out, and that should make sense to you guys. And then in between sensory motor neurons, we have what's known as interneurons. These are also known as associated neurons. And they're connectors, right? They're in between, and they can carry or inhibit signals through the CNS pathways. Most of them are in the CNS. Most of the body's neurons are interneurons. Now, here's the thing. These do math. These make decisions. So I have a sensory input. Let's say, you know, and we'll look at this in lab as well. You know, you're cooking, right? I do it all the time. I got burns all over me, and I touch a hot plate, you know, like a hot pan, and your hand flies off almost immediately, yeah? Well, that's what's known as a spinal reflex. There is a pain nerve that senses, hey, you're gonna do damage to your skin if you leave that there. It sends a sensory signal into the spinal cord. It connects with an inner neuron. The inner neuron says, damn, you better move your hand away. And it literally loops through your spinal cord and causes a particular group of muscles to contract to pull your hand away from that painful stimuli, okay? What's doing that? What's making the decision? The sensory neuron? No, it's conveying information. The motor neuron? No, it's conveying information. The interneuron is the computer system inside of the central nervous system. It's the one that's doing the integration. More on that in lab. We're actually going to be doing a bunch of different activities with spinal reflexes in lab. You know, you take the mallet and you start smacking people on the knee and all that. That's what we're going to be doing next time around. Okay, so that's it for that. We're going on to bigger and much better things, in my opinion, because we're touching on physiology now. There's a new class offered next semester. It's bio. C241, it's biochemistry for people who don't like chemistry. Is that an oxymoron? If you guys, this is recommended, okay? Brett's teaching it. This is a recommended class because it helps. If you're going into, you know, the medical field, the next thing you're gonna have to be tackling is biochemistry because you need to understand biochemistry in order to understand pharmacology. So, heads up on that one. I would highly recommend you take this course. Moving on. Okay. Bet you never thought you'd see electricity subject again, right? So opposite charges are attracted to each other. Now, again, I use the analogy of, or I use the example of taking magnets. Yes, here's a positive end, here's a negative end, and whoop, they're going to be attracted to each other. There's a force that attracts opposites. Opposites attract. Now, We have energy transferred, released when the charges move towards one another, and required to pull it away is going to require energy. There's also a phenomenon known as voltage potential. It's the difference of charges in two areas that would force a charge to move from one area to the other. Okay. This is called potential because when you move, the charges move from one area to the other, it's like flowing water and it has the ability to do work. It has the potential to do work, and that's why we call it voltage potential. Okay. So the way I look at it is, again, like flowing water. If you have here's a dam. Here's the high water, this is the low water. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna put, you know, you're gonna open the dam, water's gonna go through, it's gonna spin this turbine, right? It spins the turbine because the water's going through, and then that turbine spinning is gonna generate electricity. Okay. When will the water not go through? When it's equal in height, right? So all I'm saying here is that this has the potential to do work. If I take a bunch of charges across the cell membrane, here's the cell membrane, and the charges now are built up on one side or the other, that also has the potential to do work because the charges want to flow through just like water. So please keep that concept in mind. The membrane potential now basically is the difference of charges on the separated by the membrane. Now again, let me reiterate for people, hopefully you guys know this, phospholipid bilayer, we're gonna talk about charged particles, right? Ions, sodium, potassium, chloride, calcium, ions cannot pass through cell membranes directly. You need channels. Now the cell has the ability to either open these channels or close these channels based on certain conditions. So I take a voltmeter, a really sensitive voltmeter, and I put a lead, one side, one of the leads is outside of the cell, here's my cell membrane, right, my phospholipid bilayer, okay? And then I put the other lead inside of the cell. And what's going to read is roughly, in this case, this is a neuron, all right? It's gonna read negative 70 millivolts. In other words, what I'm telling you guys is that outside of the cell, relative to inside of the cell, is positive. Inside of the cell is negative. Why? Just because that's the way it's mapped by magic, and that's the way the magic happens, or what's the driver of this entire charge differentiation between outside and inside?
Concentration gradient.
What produces the concentration gradient? Sodium potassium pumps, right? So we have, again, I want to make sure we're covered. Here's Senor cell. In each cell, there's a tremendous amount of sodium potassium pumps, and it utilizes ATP, and it kicks out, how many times have I gone over this? Three sodiums, and it's going to then pump in to potassium. So here's my bank account. I write you a check for three, I only get two back. I write you a check for three, I only get two back. I write you get it, right? Okay. What's my bank account gonna be?
Negative.
Negative. So inside of every single living cell, because every single living cell in the body has this scenario going on, it's going to be negative relative to outside, it'll be positive. Why? Because I'm kicking out three positive ions and I'm only gaining two. I'm kicking out three and I'm only gaining two. See the burns? Right there. There's another one right there. I think I'd be more careful in the kitchen. Okay? Now, so here it is, set by the sodium potassium pump. Ta-da, magic. Not really. When the potassium ion channels are open, potassium wants to leave. Am I correct in saying that? Why? Because there's more potassium inside than outside. When sodium channels open, where's sodium going to go? Out or in? If I had channels here that were specific to sodium, and sodium channels, imagine them opening. Use your imagination. Where is sodium going to go? I need everybody to understand that. It's going to go in, right? Why? Because as these pumps are pumping sodium out, there's a tremendously higher gradient of sodium outside than inside. And we know that things go from a high concentration and diffuse, if they can, if the gates are open, into a lower concentration, right? Now, here's a question for you. What's going to happen to this cell if I get a bunch of sodium coming in, as far as the charge is concerned? We need to start thinking about this logically. Here's my bank account. I got a bunch of dollars coming into my bank account. Is my bank account going to be positive or negative? It's going to be positive. The more dollars that come into my bank account, the more positive my bank account is going to become. The more dollars that leave my bank account, the more negative it's going to become. Now, why am I spending time with this? Because neurons have the ability where gates are going to open and close at certain times, and they're specific to sodium and potassium. So if you don't understand the basics of this, everything else that we talk about from this point on is going to go right over your head. There is more sodium outside the cell than inside. There's more potassium inside the cell than outside. And for most cells, other than muscle cells and nerve cells, this is the way the cell spends its entire life. However, muscle and nerve are special. They're special because they have gates that are able to open and close, specific to sodium and potassium. All right. Here it is. Voltage-gated channels can open and close. Other channels open and close by different mechanisms, and we'll talk about that. So here's my voltmeter, and this is not in volts, by the way. It's in millivolts, right? Thousands of a volt. And in a given, you know, it fluctuates from different neurons, but let's just say the average neuron is going, the membrane potential is going to reside roughly negative 70 millivolts. That's a number you need to burn into your brain. Okay. This is all a cell. All of this entire cell, this nerve cell, it's a multipolar cell in this case, has cell membrane surrounding all the parts, so we're not going to be able to allow for just diffusion, free diffusion of ions. It won't go through the phospholipid bilayer. Okay.
The human brain alone contains about 100 billion nerve cells.
Dang it. 100 billion nerve cells times 10,000 of those possible connections, right? Imagine that. That's just mind-boggling how many connections can be made in a brain.
A neuron, like every other cell, has positively and negatively charged ions inside and outside. Further, a resting neuron has a greater negative charge on the inside surface of the plasma membrane and a greater positive charge on the outside surface. This partitioning of charge creates a voltage difference across the membrane known as the resting membrane potential, which can be measured using a voltmeter. On average, an intracellular electrode records a value of minus 70 millivolts. The resting membrane potential depends on two factors. First, it depends on the presence of sodium and potassium gradients across the plasma membrane. Specifically, there are more sodium ions outside the neuron than inside, and more potassium ions inside the neuron than outside.
So this is, I like this video because, you know, again, this is something I couldn't show you, but this is really, if you could see it at this level, this is what it would look like. All the red, as you know, are sodium. Look at the concentration of sodium outside versus inside. You just have a few boop boop sodiums, right? And then of course the opposite scenario is going on where you have a tremendous more amount of potassium inside than outside, okay? Fundamentals number one, right here.
Second, the resting membrane potential depends on the differential permeability of the plasma membrane to sodium and potassium ions. Leak channels in the plasma membrane allow sodium and potassium ions to diffuse or leak down their concentration gradients.
Now, I haven't mentioned this yet. The plot thickens. Everybody's on the edge of their seat, I see. Okay. In any given cell membrane, you have channels, leak channels, amongst others, that are specific to sodium and potassium. So, here is a potassium leak channel. Where is potassium leaking? Is it leaking out or in? It's leaking out because there's a higher concentration inside than outside. So if it's able to pass, and it is through these specific channels, sodium continually leaks out. Potassium is continually leaking out. Well, here's a sodium leak channel. Where is sodium? Is it leaking in or out? In. Okay, great. This is happening constantly. What they're not showing you is interdispersed among these leak channels is we got sodium potassium pumps that are literally doing the exact opposite of these leak channels, right? My sodium potassium pump, use your imagination, is kicking sodiums out and it's pumping potassiums in. And then those potassiums that come in leak out, and then they're pushed back, they're pumped back in, and then they leak out, and they're pumped back in, and then they leak out. And the exact same opposite scenario is going on with sodium. Sodium's pumped out, and then it leaks in. It's pumped out, and then it leaks in. Now you may wonder, why in the world do we have this setup? And hopefully this will become clear to you in just a little bit. I mean, think about how much energy you're wasting. I've said this before. Right now, you guys sitting on your butts, 40% of the energy that you're burning, the calories that you're burning, are going to running these sodium potassium pumps. That's a pretty significant amount. You know, the rest is, of course, you're breathing in and out and burning calories that way. But sodium potassium pumps are continually working. Now, the permeability of the cell membrane to sodium and potassium is not equal. What do I mean by that? I'm saying that the cell membrane is more permeable to potassium. In other words, what I'm saying is that there's more potassium leaking out at any given time than sodium leaking in. So that's gonna cause my cell to become even more negative, is it not? If I have more positives leaking out and I have fewer positives coming in, again, it's the bank account scenario where my bank account is going to become more and more negative.
The membrane contains many more potassium leak channels than sodium leak channels. Thus, the membrane is much more permeable, or leaky, to potassium ions. As positively charged potassium ions leak out of the neuron, the inside surface of the membrane becomes negatively charged compared to the outside surface. If potassium was the only ion moving, the potential would stabilize at minus 90 millivolts. However,
okay, this is important what she's saying here. If, let's say we eliminate sodium channels, and so no sodium can leak in. Well, in other words, we would have less positive ions coming in, but we'd still have the same amount of leaking of potassium out, which means it would become even more negative. Okay? That's what's known as the equilibrium constant of potassium. It's negative 90 millivolts. But that's not the scenario, right?
Positively charged sodium ions leak into the neuron, which slightly offsets the negative charge and raises the voltmeter reading to minus 70 millivolts. Sodium-potassium pumps actively transport sodium ions out of the neuron and potassium ions back in, compensating for the sodium and potassium leaks. Thus, the pumps help to maintain the resting membrane potential.
So, great video. If you didn't understand that, I would recommend that you watch it as many times as you need to get that very, you know, stabilized, because that's the basics of what we're going to be talking about literally for the next three lectures. So like I said, we're going to pump three out, we're going to pump two in, sodium potassium pump. Here it is. Now look at the millimolar equivalent. Now you really don't need to know, 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd, right? A huge number. And what this means is that millimoles, there's a thousandth of that, whatever. The takeaway here is that you can see the concentration of potassium inside is 140 versus outside is 5. And look, we have a different scenario here. The concentration of sodium outside is 140 and inside is 15, right? We have this differentiation of concentration. And let me tell you, sodium wants to get in and potassium wants to leave, right? They want to go down their concentration gradients. So this is a pretty busy image. And like I said, this is just a recap of what I said. Sodium, potassium, sodium pumps are pumping sodium out, and then it just leaks in. And then it's pumped out, and then it leaks in. And then it pumps out, and it leaks in. The same scenario is happening, but opposite, right, of potassium here. Potassium is pumped in, and then it leaks out. Potassium is pumped in, and then it leaks out. However, like the video said, there are more potassium leak channels, and thus, at any given time, there's more potassium leaking out than sodium leaking in. And that's going to bring, in other words, there's more dollars leaving my bank account than coming in, and that's going to make my bank account go more and more negative. So this is why our resting membrane potential, the differentiation of charge between the outside and inside, is negative. Okay. So here's some ion channels. We see that what you need to get out of this is they're specific. So I have a specific ion channel for sodium, and I have a specific ion channel for potassium. So a sodium channel won't let potassium pass, and a potassium channel won't let sodium pass. Everybody with me there? They're just specific. That's what you need to get out of this. I just said all this, okay? Now, again, this is the scenario with every living cell in your body. Every living cell has a resting membrane potential that is negative. In some cells, it's different. You know, muscle cells, like we said, is negative 90. Neurons, most neurons reside around negative 70, but they're always a negative membrane potential. Nerves and muscle now have the ability to depolarize. They're special. They have different membrane proteins than all of the other types of cells, and thus they're able to depolarize. And we're going to get into this in just a moment. So please burn this into your memory here. This is a scenario where here's the inside of a cell, here's potassium. What is PR?
Protein.
Negatively charged, negatively charged, okay? And then outside, if you intracellular fluid is here, extracellular fluid, this is the scenario where there's more sodium and chloride outside. There's more potassium and proteins inside. Please remember this. What they're saying here is that because potassium leak is more leaky, the cell membrane is more permeable to potassium and there's more leaking out of it, it's going to push this membrane potential even more negative as, again, a positive ion leaks out. Okay. So here it is. This is a leak channel allowing potassium to leak out. Do proteins leak out in a healthy cell? No. In the extracellular fluid, there is virtually no proteins, unless the cell is, you know, damaged, disrupted, and all of its contents spill out all over the place. But in a normal, healthy scenario, an extracellular fluid has virtually no proteins in it. Okay. So, again, if we were just, look, if we had a scenario where only potassium was leaving and no sodium was leaking in and only potassium was leaking out, it would be around 90 millivolts because potassium would just keep leaking out and leaking out and leaking out, right? However, what's going on is we have a combination of potassium leaking out and we got sodium also leaking in. Now again, when a positive ion starts to leak in, what's going to happen is it's going to go from negative 90 to about negative 70. Is it going to become less negative, right? If I have negative $90 in my bank account, someone gives me 20 bucks, I have negative $70 in my bank account. So it makes it less negative, or you could look at it as more positive. Either way, that's the scenario going on. Okay. Look, if potassium couldn't leave and sodium could come in, then it would become even more positive. Look, it went from negative 70 all the way to positive 66. Okay, but we know that's not the scenario, right? The scenario is not that. The scenario is the cell membrane's permeable to both potassium and sodium. Okay. Is there anybody that's confused with this concept right now? Brave enough to raise their hand. Because I need to gauge whether or not you guys are getting this. So equilibrium potential, here we have sodium, it's 145 millimoles outside, and then intra means inside, right? Extra means outside, extracellular fluid, intracellular fluid, and it's less inside. And that's the idea that you need to get there, okay? So here's two swimming pools, okay? If we have some sodium leaking this way or sodium leaking one way or the other, it's such a small amount, and now we're comparing intracellular from extracellular, that it doesn't really change. It says no effect on concentration, and that's not exactly true. It's just a minuscule, minute effect on the overall concentration. So that's something also you need to keep in mind. So what I'm saying is, as sodium and potassium is either leaking one direction or another, it doesn't change the overall concentration gradient of either the inside the cell or outside the cell because it's just so small amount going in or out. Okay? Very, very unnoticeable change in the concentration. Okay, so we also have non-leak channels. This is when we're gonna kind of superimpose some more complexity on this now. So on any particular neuron, you may find a combination of these other types of channels. Right? There's a chemically gated channel, a ligand gated channel. You guys already know about this, right? That's the acetylcholine receptor on the muscle side of the motor end plate. Acetylcholine binds to it and it opens and then we get sodium rushing in. Okay. Here's another example of the neurotransmitters glutamate or GABA. We're going to talk about that. These are the two biggies in the neurotransmitters in the brain. You probably heard of monosodium glutamate, right? That's why it gives some people headaches sometimes. We'll discuss why that is. And then there's GABA, and this is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. Much more on this later. Then you have intracellular chemically gated channels. These are known as second messenger systems. We'll talk, so binding to the outside membrane or receptor is going to cause this sequence of events taking place. These are called G proteins. We'll look at that. We have voltage gated channels. We talked about those before. You know, remember when the calcium voltage gated channels open and calcium rushes into the neuron, the axon terminal, and then it causes exocytosis. We have mechanically gated channels. They open and close in response to physical deformation, pressure, right? Here, look, here's a mechanically gated channel. This is I'm the inside of the cell. This is the inside. This is outside. And this is how this works. I can feel this because I'm pushing on it. Now watch, something pushes on it and that channel opens. This channel is specific to sodium. When it pushes and it opens, where's sodium gonna go? It's gonna go in, right? Because it push, it opens, it allows sodium to come in, and sodium rushes in. It's the first step to an action potential. Then we have thermogated channels. What do you suppose opens or closes those guys? Temperature. Okay, hot, cold. Chemically gated, again, we saw this. Here's a ligand-gated channel. Here's the receptor. Let's say it's for acetylcholine. Acetylcholine binds to the receptor, and we get this sodium channel opening. Sodium rushes in, and enough of sodium rushes in, it's going to cause an action potential. We're going to get there in just a moment. Okay. A voltage-gated channel, we have a change in voltage across the membrane. It's closed. There's a certain change in voltage, and it opens. Okay, pretty straightforward stuff. So when we look at the resting potential, and this is important, anything that's going to cause it to become more positive. Do you guys see that this on a typical nerve, the resting membrane potential in an unactivated nerve is roughly negative 70 millivolts. Anything that goes more positive is called the depolarization. Okay. Now, here's where we need to start thinking. What would cause this to become more positive? What scenario? What's that? Absolutely. So if this cell is just hanging out here at negative 70, it's like, then all of a sudden some sodium comes in. Well, isn't that going to cause the inside of the cell to become more positive, thus depolarizing? Yes. What's another scenario that would cause the cell to become more positive? Ready? A negative ion leaving. Think about it. If I have a cell at negative 70 millivolts and a positive ion comes in, such as sodium, it's going to become more positive. If I have the same scenario and I have a negative ion like chloride leaving, isn't it going to be more positive because a negative ion's leaving? Yes. Okay? If a negative ion leaves the cell becomes more positive. And here we go, look, same thing. This is called hyperpolarization. So the cell's just chilling at negative 70, nothing's happening, but now all of a sudden, let's say a potassium channel opens and potassium leaves the cell. Well, a positive ion leaving the cell is gonna cause the membrane potential to go lower, right? More negative or less positive. And thus, this is called a hyperpolarization. Or what's the other scenario now? Cells chilling at negative 70 and chloride channels open. Where's chloride going to go? Whoops. Where's chloride in this scenario? Where is the higher concentration of chloride? Outside. So if chloride channel opens, chloride, my friends, is going to rush in and this is going to become more negative. Why? Because I have a negative ion coming in. Does everybody see that? Okay. Do you have a question? Correct. Yes. As in chloride. Okay. Right. Yes. Yeah. We'll get to all the very, you know, the intricacies of this a little bit later. Yeah. The wheels are turning, I like that.
Okay.
You're thinking. Okay, so again, look, if my cell becomes, if I have either a positive ion coming in, it's going to cause this to be my cell, resting membrane potential to start to depolarize. Or if I have a negative ion leaving, right? Same thing. This is the exact opposite. If I have a positive ion leaving, such as potassium, or I have chloride coming in, it's going to cause the cell membrane, resting membrane potential to be disturbed, and it's going to cause hyperpolarization. Please understand that concept, because we're going to build on that. So we have to talk about graded potentials, and these are not action potentials. Do not get these confused. An action potential is an all or nothing phenomenon. It's like a gun firing. It's either fires or it doesn't, okay? Graded potentials, however, are different. I'll explain why. Well, unlike an action potential, well, they're short-lived still. They're local changes in membrane potential. And the stronger the voltage changes and the farther the current flows. So the stronger the voltage change, the farther it will go throughout that nerve, but it's still considered a local activity. In other words, it doesn't go across the entire axon like an action potential would. From gated ion channels, results in depolarization or hyperpolarization. Okay. They're named according to their location and function. So it could be a receptor potential, which is known as a generator potential. They're graded potentials and receptors of sensory neurons. Okay. And I'll show you what that means in a moment. Then we have a postsynaptic potential. It's a neuron-graded potential. Images to come. So, at this point, I want to show you just something, an overall concept that we need to understand here. Multipolar neuron, okay? This is the dendrites. This is the axon hillock. That's right. Axon and then the terminals, right? Like I said before, in this particular, all neurons, the signal only travels in one direction down the axon, and that direction's this way. Everybody with me? Okay? Now, this entire neuron, it's at rest, and the resting membrane potential is at negative 70 in this scenario. Everybody with me? This is where the resting membrane potential is located. Okay. Now, I get a cell communicating with this dendrite here. There's another neuron. Here's another axon of another neuron coming down, communicating with that particular dendrite. Or maybe the axons, let's do it right here, is coming direct contact with the actual cell body. Follow me. Signal comes down this axon. This axon is then going to release a particular neurotransmitter. There's a ligand gated channel here that when that neurotransmitter is released, it's going to cause sodium channels to open. But, watch this, So I'm just chilling, my cells chilling at negative 70. Signal comes down, neurotransmitters released. Sodium channel's open. Where's sodium gonna go in? Or in? I guess just gave it away. Sodium's gonna go in, right?
Yeah.
What's gonna happen to my membrane potential? More positive or more negative?
Positive.
More pop, watch. It's gonna go up. Right? Sodium rushing in, membrane potential is gonna go up. Now, you see this negative 55? That, my friends, is called threshold. And what that means is that this cell is not going to send an action potential down its axon unless it reaches threshold. Every neuron has a particular threshold. Did it reach threshold?
No.
No. But now, I got yet another nerve that's communicating here, and it also sends a signal, and it's gonna allow sodium to come in and wait, watch, boom. It's gonna get more positive. And then I have another nerve here that's gonna send signal, and I have another nerve, and another nerve, and another nerve. And pretty soon I have all adequate amounts of nerves firing, and adequate amounts of neurotransmitter released, adequate amounts of sodium channels opening, and watch, all of a sudden now, I'm gonna get to threshold. Does everybody see that? This cell has now gotten to threshold. Why? Because it's had enough signaling and it's enough sodium leaked in, and the sodium leaking in is gonna cause it to become more positive and more positive until I get to threshold. Then, here in the axon hillock, this is where the action potential actually starts to be generated. So what happens now is that sodium, now there are voltage-gated sodium channels that start here. I'm just giving you guys an overview. And all of a sudden, watch, at this point, right now, voltage-gated sodium channels open in mass numbers. What's gonna happen to my membrane potential? Is it gonna go positive or negative? Watch, from this point on, boom. Sodium gates open here. Sodium channels open here. Everybody with me? Sodium channels open here, and from this point is when they open. Sodium channels open. We know that sodium is gonna rush in like freaking crazy. And when sodium's rushing in, it becomes more positive. And more sodium rushes in, and it becomes more positive. And more sodium, and then all of a sudden, at this point, the sodium channels close, and guess what? Wait for it. Potassium channels open. Potassium channels open. So from this point here, everybody look. From this point here, sodium channels are open, right? Then they close, and in the green now, potassium channels open. Where's potassium gonna go? Where's potassium? Where's sodium rushes in, potassium goes where? Out. If I have a positive ion leaving the cell, it's like dollars leaving my bank account. Here's my bank account going more and more negative. But look, the potassium channels are slower to close than the sodium channels. And what happens, again, remember that if all the potassium channels were simply open, you would be at around roughly negative 90. Remember that earlier on in the lecture? So the potassium is gonna continue to come out as long as that channel is open. And then right about this point in time here, the potassium channels close. Everybody with me? Okay? But the plot thickens even further. Why? Because look, in this particular area, in this axon hillock, I have now opened these sodium channels and this phenomenon has taken place. But then, look, I'm gonna take this axon and I'm gonna blow it up. Here's the axon hillock. This is where it starts, okay? Watch, sodium rushes in. Sodium rushes in, right? Because we have an action potential. So you guys see sodium rushing in there, yes? You just gotta get this. Sodium is gonna diffuse in this direction, and as sodium rushes in, it also diffuses in this direction here. Okay. Now, I have voltage-gated sodium channels here. When the sodium comes in and diffuses, now this area of the cell, my friends, is going to, look, sodium comes in, more sodium rushes in, and then boom, now this area undergoes action potential, and now sodium floods in like crazy, right? Sodium flooding in like crazy is gonna diffuse in this direction and in this direction. Everybody with me? And then all of the sodium now diffusing in is gonna cause this area to undergo threshold. And then boom, sodium rushes in here. And then this area, and then boom, and sodium rushes in here, and then this area. And pretty soon, you get this all the way down, going in that direction. That's an action potential. Because throughout this entire axon, this axon has voltage-gated sodium and potassium channels. Right? How come it doesn't go backwards? I told you that, look, this area right here, let's say right now that sodium is rushing in here and sodium is rushing in here, and it doesn't care, it's gonna diffuse in this direction and it's gonna diffuse in this direction. But how come the only next spot to depolarize is gonna be on towards the right going this way and not going towards the left? And the answer is because when sodium is rushing in this area we just depolarized, is it not, right? It goes from this one to this one to this one, right? Everybody see this? Look, this one is hyperpolarized. It's so far away from threshold that even though sodium is coming in and diffusing in both directions, it's not gonna bring this cell at this time above threshold to have another, or this portion of the cell rather, above threshold to have another action potential. That way the action potential only travels in one direction. Okay. I can remember learning this going, holy shit, this is incredible. Right? This is good stuff. So an action potential is going to propagate along this neuron again, and it's not going to propagate along a fat cell or, you know, a bone cell, because those cells don't have those voltage-gated sodium channels and potassium channels. So that's why muscle and nerve is special in that it can depolarize. Now, what we're gonna talk about later on, or throughout this rest of this lecture, which is shortening up too soon here, is we're gonna talk about how are we able to generate an action, how much influence do we need here in order for an action potential to be generated? Well, what we really need to do, it's very simple, we need to bring that cell up to threshold. And if we bring the cell up to threshold, we will have, it's like me having a trigger, right? And if I just pull on the trigger very lightly, the gun's not gonna fire. But if I pull on the trigger a little bit harder, gun's not gonna fire. If I pull on it harder, gun's not gonna fire. Pretty soon I pull that trigger hard enough where that trigger plunges down and that gun is gonna, boom, it's gonna fire, right? It's an all or nothing principle. So again, I want to repeat this because this is important. If I want to stimulate the cell, if it's either stimulatory or inhibitory, watch. If this neuron right now causes sodium gates to open, am I stimulating the cell or inhibiting it? I'm stimulating it because it's coming closer to threshold. Okay? But what about GABA? Look, here's a GABA neuron releasing GABA right here. And GABA, if I remember correctly, is going to cause chloride ions to open. Okay, where's chloride going to go? Inside. Is chloride negative? Yeah. It is. So look, instead of, watch this, look, GABA channels open, all of a sudden my cell becomes further and further away from threshold. It's an inhibitory neurotransmitter. Why is it inhibiting? It's because it's bringing, it all comes down to how, if you're going to hit threshold or not. And if you bring that cell membrane further from threshold, in other words, more negative, it has inhibitory effects. If you bring that cell resting membrane potential towards threshold, it's gonna be a stimulatory effect, right? You hear about drugs that are inhibitors or stimulators. This is it. This is what we're talking about. It's the ability to either get that cell closer to threshold, stimulatory, or further away, which is inhibitory. So please keep that in mind. This is important concepts that you need to understand. Yes?
Sorry, I don't know if I missed it, but did you say if this is graded potential or actual potential?
Okay, good question. So what I'm talking about is here, at the cell membrane, it would be a phenomenon known as a graded potential. Now, what does that mean? We're gonna look at this more next time. I'm not gonna have enough time to do this. But if I have like one of these guys, let's say these are all stimulatory neurons, okay? And I just have one of them firing, releasing neurotransmitters, sodium rushes in, well, it's only gonna go up here and it's not gonna cause any stimulation, yeah? I need more neurons to come in and release their neurotransmitters so more sodium comes in, and now more sodium comes in, and then boom, pretty soon enough sodium came in where now I'm gonna hit that action potential, and that action potential is generated here first at the axon hillock, and then I'm gonna have it travel down, right? Every single time, if I hit threshold, this cell hits threshold, it's going to generate an action potential, if it's healthy. If I want to inhibit, I'm going to do the exact opposite. I want to bring it further from action potential, or from threshold, rather. This is the general concept. If you guys get this, you're going to be good. Of course, there's a lot more intricacies that we're going to build on this, but what it comes down to is closer to threshold or further, really what it comes down to, okay? So again, Let's look now. We only have a few more minutes left, about 5 more minutes, and I need to start going faster because I'm even further behind than I used to be, okay? So we have a now this is a graded potential, and this is not an action potential. They're different. Action potential, as soon as it happens, it's gonna propagate along the axon. A graded potential is where I make a stimulus, and the cell becomes more positive, but then as those positive ions coming in kind of diffuse away, it's only local, right? It loses its positivity. You can see that. So again, distance. So I stimulate here, it's gonna cause sodium ions to rush in, it becomes more positive here, but as I move further to the left and the right, as those sodium ions diffuse out, it becomes less and less positive. That's a graded potential. Okay. So here we have dendrites and dendritic spines. Here's an inhibitory synapse. Okay, so you can see here that there's excitatory synapses, and of course there are inhibitory synapses. And we just said the excitatory ones are gonna cause positive ions to rush in or allow positive ions to rush in. And inhibitory are gonna allow negative ions to rush in, okay? And now, look at this though, here's, and this is simplified too, okay? Take that, you know, the cell membrane and really multiply this by thousands. Remember, we can have tens of thousands of these, one of these neurons communicating with the next. I mean, incredibly complicated, okay? So, you have glial cells here, but then all of these are axon terminals of other neurons communicating with this particular neuron. So you can see here that this has a tremendous amount of influence based on, you know, if we get a signal coming in, think about it this way. I get a signal coming in causing depolarization here. Is it gonna be as effective or matter as much here or here? It's gonna be more influential closer to the axon hillock. Because as we, if sodium rushes in here, remember, a graded potential, as we go further and further distance-wise, it has less of an impact, right? It dissipates. So of course a neuron here is gonna have less of an impact than a terminal button of another neuron here, because this is right in the axon hillock. This is where, if we really wanna stimulate to have an action potential, it's in this area, okay? Now, these can be a combination. Some of these nerves are stimulatory and others are inhibitory. And it's the overall net accumulation of ions either going positive ions in or out, negative ions in or out, that if we get the threshold, we're gonna have action potential. So here it is again, this is a graded potential. Everybody look, the stimulus causes sodium to come in. So right in this area, notice where we have one cell communicating with another cell here. And the sodium comes in, but as it moves further and further away, as it dissipates, of course, this positive charge is not as strong, right? It dissipates. So this is what, again, what's known as a graded potential. Okay? So what would happen, a couple questions here, what would happen to the potential at negative 70 millivolts if potassium channel is opened? Is it going to become more positive or more negative? Mm-hmm. Excellent. If I have potassium leaving, well, it's like dollars leaving my bank account, right? And it's going to hyperpolarize. It's going to become more negative. These are just thought questions to make sure you guys are on the right page here. So what would happen to the potential if it's at negative 65 millivolts and only potassium channels open? What would be a plausible scenario here? A, B, C, D, or E?
A.
Love it. Okay, it would be A. More potassium leaving would make it more negative or less positive. I don't care which way you look at it, but that would be the scenario. Okay, now here we go again. What would happen to the potential if only chloride channels now were able to open? So they have this nerve, it produces a neurotransmitter causing a ligand-gated chloride channel to open. What would it be? It would be A again, right? Because if I'm at negative 65 and I have chloride channels open and chloride's a negative ion and it's coming in, it's gonna be even more negative or less positive. So everybody look here. Resting membrane potential, all of a sudden, positive ions rush in. Or negative ions come out, but that's not normally the scenario. So as positive ions rush in, it's causing my membrane potential to become more positive. And this again, I repeat hopefully for the last time, is called depolarization. If I'm resting membrane potential and either positive ions go out and or negative ions come in, well, then it's gonna cause hyperpolarization. Okay? The axon hillock is the trigger zone. This is where an action potential starts. So, like I said, if we get to threshold, then an action potential is propagated. It starts in the axon hillock, and it will go all the way down the axon and the collaterals to the axon terminals. What I'm saying is, if this axon hillock, again, we get enough influence, we get enough positive ions coming in here, and it's going to trigger, we're going to get to threshold, the axon hillock is going to then generate an action potential, and that action potential, every single time, will make its way down the neuron, split to these terminal branches, and then it will cause whatever neurotransmitters are in here to be released, right? Every single time. In a healthy neuron. Okay, so look, here's the summary here. Look, so we have a stimulus. Let's say it causes sodium ions to rush in, but you'll notice as sodium ions rush in right here, as we go further down the cell body, well, it becomes less and less, right? Here it's very strong, right? It's over threshold. But where do we need it to be over threshold in order to generate an action potential? Here in the cell body? No, we need it here in the trigger zone. So we have a stimulus, it dissipates. You'll notice that this is under threshold. Does everybody see that? Is this gonna have an action potential? No, because it doesn't reach threshold. It's just that simple. But now, let's stimulate it further. We're gonna get more stimulus. Let's say we have more of these neurons releasing neurotransmitters that cause more sodium to come in. Well, if we get more sodium coming in here, or it's temporal summation, I send more action potentials down that neuron. We'll talk about that in a moment. In other words, if I send an action potential like boom, boom, well, it's gonna dissipate. But what if I go and I send an action potential that fast? It's gonna cause more sodium to come in. It's going to, at this trigger zone, it's going to be above threshold, and boom, we're gonna have action potential every single time. Right? We've reached threshold in this trigger zone. Action potential will propagate along the axon. I didn't get as far as I wanted to, but hopefully you guys got that, because if you do get this particular part of it, you're gonna be so much better than not having understood this section. So we'll see you Wednesday, or I'll probably see about a third of you on Wednesday, and that's okay. Make sure you watch the lecture. If you don't watch it from me, make sure you watch it from Brett. He's a little bit ahead of me right now. But you can watch anyone you want.